हरिओम संजय जी, वी कैन स्टार्ट व्हेनेवर यू आर रेडी।
हरिओम। सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। ॐ श्री चिन्मय सद्गुरवे नमः। योगेन चित् तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पातञ्जलि प्राञ्जलिनानतोऽस्मि। हरि ओम्। पतंजलि योग सूत्र इज कॉमनली कॉल्ड एज अष्टांग योग। फॉर ऑल दोज हु आर सीरियस अबाउट डूइंग समथिंग अबाउट देमसेल्व्स so that they reach a destination, gantavya sthanam, where karana sahita dukkha nivrutti is there, which is termed as kaivalya. There are majority of people in this world who are not even aware that they are working wrongly in this world. Out of the entire creation, only the human beings are endowed with thinking in a prospective manner. So in one stroke, majority of creation is debarred from thinking what they are doing. They only do. They don't think, they can't think what they are doing. When you can't think what you are doing, it is called a bhoga yoni. A tiger gets up in the morning and goes for taking care of his basic needs. So he goes, knows how to kill. So he kills and satiates his hunger, then feels sleepy, so sleeps. And when the urge of procreation dominates in the mind, he procreates. In none of these acts, he thinks about what he is doing, or he can think about what he is doing. One who cannot think about what he is doing is Pashu, is bound. Pasham is Bandhanam, is bound by what? Bound by lack of intellect. So in the creation, only a minuscule percentage called human beings are endowed with the faculty of thinking. So those are the only species who can act as well as think. Unfortunately, in this species called human beings, there are those who only act and do not think. All the people with tamasi pravritti, tama. Tama is a sign of a pashu in a man. So those who act but do not think is one category of human beings. Then a further refined version is the set of people who act and then think. But a very rare few people, human beings, act and then think and then act. Again, amongst this thinking and then acting people, there are very few who know how to think and what to think before acting. That means analysis of what we do, analysis of how we act is the cornerstone of investigation, called a spiritual investigation. Think about yourself and ask a question. How often did I sit quietly and ask a question to myself? What am I doing? Yes, I was born, I was raised, I went to school, got a degree, got married, created children, did a job, made some money, had my friends, indulged in some sensuous pleasures. But that's the story of every single human being. Never ever the thought comes to the mind that what I did, what I am doing, is it that what I'm supposed to do? Take a small example. We are having a vacation of 3 or 4 days now. What came to the mind? Ah, there is a vacation. So let's go there. Let's go to this hotel. Let's enjoy. Every one of us thinks of enjoying the vacation. And what is this enjoyment? Have we ever thought about it? This enjoyment is nothing but sensuous pleasures. Going for a staycation in a hotel, going to a restaurant to eat, calling over friends to merrymake, or going to friend's place to enjoy the drinks, watching the television or the Netflix or whatever the new series and etc. for the sensuous pleasure. Beyond this, we do not think anything. And if there is little more refinement, then maybe using this time to browse through Bhagavad Gita or some scripture. That too, without realizing what am I supposed to precisely do when I read the scripture. Our story ends here. That means there are very few who seriously question their behavior and wonder, why is it that an equally upcoming and successful person like Gurudev one fine day introspected himself while carrying the ashes of his close friend in a train and kept on thinking so that he could come to a logical conclusion where he realized first that the life that I am leading is not the life that I should be leading. So if we seriously introspect ourselves, and when I use the word serious, it means there should be no spurious attempt to investigate. Unfortunately, our attitude towards Adhyatma, our attitude towards scriptures or saintly people like Gurudeva is pretty superficial. We do something on Friday morning, or we exchange some WhatsApp messages about greatness of Gurudeva, and we feel we are very adhyatmic people or spiritually elevated people. Mind well, we are defrauding ourselves, cheating ourselves. The reason is, if I have taken spirituality seriously, then there should be some perceptible change in me perceived by others. But in spite of being in Adhyatma or spirituality for more than a decade or two, no virtual perceptible change has come to me. That means either what I am doing is wrong or I am not doing it in the right manner. And that is why when such a serious introspection of a spiritual aspirant goes into right direction, the first revelation that comes to anyone and should come to anyone is, my life, the way I am leading, is spiritually wrong. That is the sign, or the first sign of Abhyudaya, arousal. The spiritual arousal's first sign is to know that something is wrong, something is amiss. And then comes the question, what is wrong? And the answer to what is wrong for a spiritual aspirant is that I am doing certain things in life which I shouldn't be doing, first part. And second, I am not doing the things which I should be doing. Again, the first part is, I am doing certain things which I should not be doing. And the second part is, I am not doing the things which I should be doing. Unless this is corrected first, take it in writing, there cannot be any spiritual progress. intellectually you may talk about aparoksha anubhuti, advaita, dvaita, vishishta advaita, atman, brahman. This is all bombastic words. They will remain at word level. They will go tangentially about the head. They may impress some people around you. You may be called as an erudite scholar, a very studious person, a pandit, but it is all useless. Unless we focus on two things. First thing is, what is that I am doing which I should not be doing? And second is, what is that which I should be doing but I am not doing? That is why Patanjali Maharaj, being a Rishi of highest order, has come out with the solution as first thing first. A lady who is delivering a child, if we start telling the lady that, look, when your child goes to the school, be careful that you should take the child's study every day, that is a useless advice, because right now the emergency is to deliver the baby, not the education of the baby. Similarly, although we have studied Samadhipada, that is a far off thing as of now for us. So currently what we should be doing is to work upon ourselves, to do the first thing first, and that first thing first is the 29th most important vital sutra for newcomers like us. Entire Patanjali Yoga Sutra has gravitated down to our level. The lowest level it has come is this 29th sutra. Everything else is in the higher realms of understanding. If anyone asks a question, which is the most relevant sutra for the beginner or for anyone, then the answer is 29th sutra of Sadhana Pada, the second pada of Patanjali Yoga Sutra. Its importance cannot be measured. It is immeasurable. Anyone who wants to take Patanjali Yoga Sutra seriously, or Ashtanga Yoga Sadhana seriously, or a Raja Yoga seriously, it is here he has to focus and start. So let us all concentrate with clean and precise mind, using the depth and the penetration of the intellect to understand this correctly, so that we do not make any mistake in our sadhana. Anyone who has not understood the 29th sutra and its explanation thereafter cannot be a good sadhaka. As I told earlier, Patanjali Maharaj points out through this sutra, for an ardent sadhaka, a serious sadhaka, what is that I am doing which I shouldn't be doing is called yama. It is that which I shouldn't be doing is yama. And that which I am not doing but should be doing is called niyama. Yama is moral and prohibitive. It prohibits. No, no, no. Don't is yama. Niyama is a disciplined and constructive. Do this way. So let's first understand the difference between yama and niyama. Yama is the ethical foundation of a sadhaka. It is the base on which the building is about to be built. If the base is weak, the building cannot be built. So the foundation ethical foundation of the mind of a yogi is a yama. Niyama is the construction of the building on the top. The gist of the explanation is that which I shouldn't have done is yama, and that which I should do is niyama. So yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyanam, samadhayo, ashtavangani. These are the eight parts of Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. These are the eight stages. These are the eight parts, angas of Patanjali Yoga Sutra. What is there in Patanjali Yoga Sutra? These eight angas. And then their explanation in different padas. If the adhikari is uttama, uttama means if you are doing yoga for many births, whatever you have achieved in the earlier birth cannot go waste. So that will continue to push you up into the higher level. So those who have studied the yogas in the earlier births, and if they have completed the stages of yama, niyama, asana, dharana, dhyana, pratyahara, and they move towards dhyana and the higher level of samadhi, then they are uttamadhikari. Some of them have completed initial stages and have come to the middle stage. They need only tapa, swadhyaya, and ishvara pranidhana. They are madhyamadhikari. You and me are not neither uccha adhikari nor madhyama adhikari. And the reason why it is so is, had we been uttama adhikari or madhyama adhikari, we wouldn't have come to this class, but would have been sitting somewhere in the Himalayas practicing our sadhana. That means we must be clear that we are the Nimnastara Adhikari or Nicha Adhikari or the lower Adhikari. Once this is clear, then we are fit to undertake the study of Ashtanga. Which are the Ashtanga? Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. Out of this, the Yamas and the Niyamas are the most critical for people of the initial stage. The Yama, as I told, is abstention, not to do, prohibitive. Ahimsa, Satya, Asateya, Aparigraha, Brahmacharya are the Yamas. We are going to see each one of them in detail, because studying them in detail is a sadhana. Yama or abstention or prohibition is a nivritti paraka yoganga or nishedhatmaka yoganga. Nishedha means don't do, don't is coming, going to come in niyama. While niyama is observation. Observation means to do. Niyamyate kriyante nitaram yamyate iti niyamaha. Niyamyate kriyante. The rules that are to be observed is niyama. What is asana? Asyat ebhihi iti asanani. Asyat means posture, that which it makes it possible to sit for long hours without difficulty is asana. Now this is something very surprising. While doing the sadhana, suddenly sitting in comfortable posture for long hours, why this is given so much importance? The asana, which of course we will be seeing in detail, only this part of the Ashtanga Yoga asana has developed further, which is commonly misrepresented as yoga by everyone right from west to east. This is only one anga of Ashtanga Yoga, which unfortunately has become very famous. And unfortunately, it is called as yoga, although it is yoganga. Why the posture? The posture, because the posture relates to the body, the physical body. While working on the mind, the entire work of Patanjali Yoga Sutra is working on mind. While working on mind, if anyone feels that since I am working on mind, I do not need anything else, he will be mistaken, because no work on mind is possible if the body is not conducive for it. And what do you mean by conducive body? A body that does not give feeling that it is existing is called conducive body. What is health? Health is not absence of disease. The most common stupid understanding is health is absence of disease. No. Absence of disease, of course, is required for health, but health is the physical conduciveness for doing something. Suppose you are not sick or ill, you are free from disease, but you don't feel like doing anything. That is not health. The energy, virya, the enthusiasm for undertaking any action in the most positive frame of mind comes from the positive frame of health, physical health. And that is why creating such a health where maximum amount of energy is available in a manner whereby that energy is utilized by the mind to undertake the exercise of yama niyama is called asana exercise. So the posture that we talk about is essentially for that. We are just trying to see in short what these ashtangas are. We are going to see each ashtanga in detail. Pranayama. Prananam ayamaha. Vyayamaha agata nirgata sthitishu vistaraha itti pranayama. What is pranayam? Pranasya ayam. What is prana? The perceptible feature of prana is breath. The perceptible feature of prana is breath. Breath comes and goes. Ayam means that which comes and goes absolutely in the manner that it is expected to come and go. Mind well, none of us today in this world breathe properly. The only two people who are able to breathe properly is a newborn child and a saintly person or a rishi. Rest, everybody's breath is out of harmony. And that is why the Yoga Sutra realized that after keeping the body free of disease, the energy that is required for a yogi to undertake the Ashtanga Yoga can only be sufficiently made available if its origin, which is a prana, which comes in the perceptible form of breathing, if it is controlled so that it becomes natural and not artificial the way we are breathing. Just to give a small example, every breath is supposed to deliver a certain quantum of oxygen in the modern language or the prana to us. A good deep breath delivers about 4,500 cc's of air to us. Unfortunately, none of us take a breath sufficiently long, so we land up getting 1/4 of that. And with that, we are living for so many years, which indicates that a sufficient amount of circulation of the breathing, prananam, ayamaha, vyayamaha, exercising the control on the pranas so that agata, that is inhalation, nirgata, exhalation, sthitishu, status, vistaraha. Vistaraha meaning extending the quantum of time that you breathe in and you breathe out and stay without breath out and without breath in. So the puraka, rechaka and bahya kumbhaka and antar kumbhaka. Inhaling, waiting. Exhaling, waiting. This period of inhalation, exhalation and the waiting has to be increased so that the efficiency of breathing increases, leading to what is called as ayam of control of breath, pranayam. Then comes pratyahar, which is abstraction. We're going to see pratyahar in detail. You have to let go certain things so that you come towards the area of focus. When you read Ramayanam, so many things come to our mind. The Ayodhya Kand, the Bala Kand, the Sundar Kand, the Aranya Kand, etc., etc., etc. And then you leave one by one these Kandas, Pratyahara, and then come to only Ram. This process of leaving everything that is not needed, Pratyahara, brings you to the area where you want to focus. So such a manakalpita pradesha, when you decide, what is the manakalpita pradesha in Ramayana? Bhagavan Shri Ram. When we focus our intellect on Shri Ram, dhrutihi ekatra sthapanam iti dharana, dhrutihi ekatra sthapanam, ekam agre asit. So first you focus yourself into what is called as one focus, that is a dharana, which is concentration. Then the field of the focus of concentration, when the concentration continues for some time, at that point of time, your own consciousness and the thing that is contemplated, the consciousness of that becomes one, which is called dhyanam. Dhyaihi dhyanas jnanasya dharaha. A continuous flow of intellect or the consciousness in the form of knowledge flowing towards the object is called a dhyanam. Contemplation, temple. Templation, temple means area. Temple is an area in the head. This area is called temple. The one on the right side, mostly if you hit just above the ear, the person dies faster. That area is called temple area. That's why gun is always put here. Temple, that means specific area. We go to temple. In English, mandiram is called temple because that's an area for dhyanam. And then comes the samadhi, sama, a, and dha. That is when the dhyayartha, the object of destination, has become nirbhasa. That means the only remaining thing while meditating is alambana. That means when everything is only Rama, which I was focusing so far, nothing else is seen, it is called the samadhi. So this is how Ashtanga of yoga, in short, for the introduction we have taken. Now it is the time to go for Yama. The 30th sutra of Sadhana Pada, the second Pada, speaks about Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Aparigraha, Yamaha. What is Yama? Yama means five things. As already said, Yama is prohibitory. Prohibitory means don't do, don't do, don't do. What do you don't do? Ahimsa. Don't do himsa. Satya. What is that you don't do in Satya? Don't lie. Asteya. Don't steal. Brahmacharya. Don't indulge in sensual pleasures. Aparigraha. Don't aggrandize or collect or own. A sadhaka who is serious must very seriously think about these yamas first. Our mistake in our daily life is clearly reflected in the yamas. Let us see why the yamas are so important. The first yama is called ahimsa, and it is the topmost of all the sadhana that is done in yoga. The yamas are five, nivas are five. Total 10. But mind well, other than ahimsa, all remaining 9 work for ahimsa. You practice satya for what? For ahimsa. You practice asteya for what? For ahimsa. You practice brahmacharya for what? Ahimsa. You practice aparigraha for what? Ahimsa. You practice shaucha, tapa, santosha, etc., etc., all niyamas for what? For ahimsa. That means all yamas and niyamas are ahimsa mulaka. So great is the yama called ahimsa. That is why it is the first yama even before satya, the ahimsa comes. That is why all yamas and niyamas are actually meant for only one purpose, and the purpose is ahimsa nirmali karana. The gist, everything when perfected, all yamas and niyamas when perfected, they get transformed or transmuted into ahimsa. Truth or the satya at its peak becomes ahimsa. So in case of yamas, as we said, they are nishedhatmaka. So they are not bhavatmaka. Bhavatmaka means they are not to be performed. certain things not to be performed is yama. So there is nothing to be done to practice yamas, but avoidance is the basis of yama. I want to be practicing yama called satya from tomorrow. You can't. Why? Because yama satya is not to be done by practicing satya, but by practicing not to lie. Nishedhatmaka, not bhavatmaka. I want to be ahimsaka from tomorrow. You don't have to do anything. Just stop the hiusa. Don't do hiusa is ahimsa. Don't lie is satya. Don't steal is asteya. Don't do sensual pleasure is brahmacharya. Don't collect is aparigraha. So, nishedhatmaka, not bhavatmaka. Let us see the first one called ahimsa. Mind well, as earlier told, ahimsa is the cornerstone, the basis, the foundation. Yama is the ethical foundation. And in that ethical foundation, the most important stone of that foundation is ahimsa. We have some funny concept about ahimsa and we think we are ahimsaka. How ahimsaka? I don't beat anybody. I don't slap anybody. I don't go and really take a stick in my hand and trouble anybody. That is the most vulgar definition of ahimsa. Then what is the real definition of ahimsa? Sarvatha kayena manasa vacha. First is sarvatha, at all times. Kayena manasa vacha, by body, mind and speech. Sarvada. At all times, pranatyadi sankata kale api, even if you are in danger. Each word is important because some questions are bound to come in mind. And the answer of that, those questions lies here in this definition. This definition is by none else but Vachaspati Mishra, the adept yogi. So no word goes wrong here. Sarvatha kayena manasa vacha sarvada pranatyayadi sankata kale api ityartha sthavara jangam adi sarva praninam. Sthavara jangam, the one which is steady and stationary prani, means what? The trees, they don't move. Jangama, the animal that moves, all the moving animals, the snakes, the tigers, whatever animal you talk of, that which moves and that which doesn't move, sthavara and jangama, sarva praninam, anabhidroha pidana buddhi, anabhidroha. There should be no violence or commotion with pidana buddhi rahityam. When your intellect or the mind is completely devoid of thought of troubling anyone. Ityam eva yoganga bhuta ahimsa. When ahimsa is to be practiced in its right spirit, it is not possible to do so unless remaining yamas and niyamas are practiced with perfection. The one who becomes more truthful, the one who practices asteya, the one who practices brahmacharya, automatically increases the level of ahimsa. So ahimsa cannot be practiced in separation. Ahimsa is bolstered and practiced and and is grown in size only by practicing remaining yamas and niyamas. How is ahimsa described? How much is the ultimate stage? How much ahimsak he is? The best narration comes from Jnaneshwar Maharaj in his scripture Jnaneshwari. He says about ahimsa, asudaila vara nakh lagel ambara iya buddhi kara chalo nedi. The meaning of this particular couplet is asudaila vara. Even if the yogi thinks in his mind that if I raise my hand, my nails might hurt the wind. The wind that is blowing, it might get hurt by the nails while I raise my hand. So he remains in one sthiti to avoid the ahimsa. That is the level of ahimsa that we are talking about. So mind well, ahimsa here, which many a times comes to our mind, that what if somebody tries to attack me, I also should attack him. It is in self-defense. If the snake is coming to bite me, I must preserve my life. These are all explanations and questions, and the answers given to them are in the Vyavaharika Satta. The whole purpose of yoga is to get ourselves out of this world. When you want to get out of this world, then you cannot have a solution from the world. If you, for that matter, everybody tries to give an example of Bhagavan Sri Krishna telling Arjuna that Yudhaswa, was it not that he was asking him to do himsa? Mind well, the advice given by Sri Krishna was a worldly advice as far as and as long as the Arjuna was in the worldly picture. That is why the result of what action he was doing, mind well, Bhagavan was very clear and clever in telling him what he would get out of this. Hatvava prapsisi swargam, jitvava bhokshase mahim. Arjuna, if you won, you will get a bigger Rajya. And if you really die, you will get Swarga. But Patanjali Yoga Sutra is focused on not having anything from the world. The Swarga also comes into the world. It is a Shastra to go beyond the world. So the Ahimsa that needs to be practiced for this is Ahimsa of the highest order. That is why Ahimsa is Sarva Yama Niyama Atishayitva. That is why Mahabharata himself says Ahimsa Paramo Dharmaha. Although the second line says Dharma Himsa Tathayvacha. Dharma Himsa Tathayvacha. If Himsa is justified in certain situations as Dharma, do not forget, that is the second part of the statement. The first is Paramo Dharma. Paramo Dharma is Ahimsa. That is because when a Jnana Sthiti engulfs the mind, then such a mind has the correct perception of Ahimsa. So only a Jnani knows what Ahimsa is. For all of us, everything is relative. If lady in a self-defense, in order to preserve her chastity, kills the aggressor, it is not an ahimsa according to Dharma Shastra. But the one in whose mind even the aggressor has become consciousness and Chaitanya, as in case of Mirabai, she did not do any kind of violence against the aggressor who tried to have a bad spell on the chastity of Mirabai. That is why whose standard for ahimsa is the greatest? Jnaneshwar Maharaj gives the answer. Taise jnana manachiye bheti sarisechi ahimsechi bimba uthi. The one whose mind is completely engulfed by the jnanam is the only one who can understand what real ahimsa is. Mahatma Gandhi, while conducting the public meetings, used to wave his hand very slowly for the mosquitoes so that the mosquito should not be hurt. And when he shifted to Sevagram, in the early days of Sevagram, lots and lots of snakes used to come there, and for the sake of some treatment in case there is snake bite, he was keeping potassium permanganate crystal in a small bottle near him. And whenever the snakes came, and more so during the rainy season, the snakes used to come there because of the water, each snake was lifted and again was left back into the jungles. Now, what happened to the ahimsa here? If they kill me and if I get poison, I am doing such a great work of freedom struggle, and if I die, then who can give the freedom? No, that is not the way ahimsa is practiced, because a jnani practices it at its highest peak. If Gurudev would have thought that in Uttarkashi, when I'm meditating by mistake, if there is a scorpion that comes out and suppose it bites my thigh when I am actually contemplating, then what will happen? That thought doesn't come, because jnana manachiye bheti, when the knowledge dawns in the mind, ahimsa in its true form reflects in the mind of yogi. So this is how ahimsa is the moola tattva of all the yamas and the niyamas. We are going to see again few thoughts on ahimsa, but this is an outline of ahimsa, what ahimsa is. The second is satya. But before going to the satya, let us talk about our own ahimsa. We are not going to talk about the snake in our life, because we don't even see them. We are not going to beat anybody, because anybody who is so angry that he beats somebody doesn't deserve to come to the satsanga of Patanjali Yoga Sutra. He's a very base animal. He will not come for Yoga Sutra. So how does ahimsa in my life matters as a sadhaka? Kayena, vachena, manaha. These three mediums I have. Do I by any chance create droha to the other person? While just walking on the road, I pluck the leaf from a tree. Will you be happy if somebody plucks a nail from you? It will pain you. Tree doesn't complain to us, is what we feel. But there is a droha in tree, we are not aware of it. The modern biological science tells us one thing, that whenever the woodcutter tries to come closer to the trees release a kind of tannin, which is bitter in taste. That is their way of protesting. That means every single prani, sthavar or jangam, every single creation, moving or non-moving, does respond or react to the aggression. Every response to aggression is called a droha. And if you create a droha to anybody by your body action or the speech, then you have committed ahimsa. So what is the solution for this? The solution is, do not do any act by body, mind or speech if it is going to create a droha. Let us take very small examples of a droha committed by the one who is speaking right now. When my wife makes anything for me to eat, she has put in good amount of efforts to make me eat something which she gives me first and she has it later. So there is a sacrifice also involved in it. But my mind is focused on what is given to me, and then what I do is, oh, again you made the same vegetable today. What has happened? What has happened is somebody who did this with so much of effort, with a complete intention of you should eat the good food, is being rewarded by my speech, a comment which created a droha in her mind, because she feels at least for a moment, ki how much whatsoever I do for this man, he always abuses me or gives a negative comment. Then what is the solution for this? The solution is, accept everything gracefully as God's gift through the wife. The food that I'm eating is the result of the punyam that I have done, which is made possible for me to eat because of Bhagavan, who in turn wanted me to eat the food, so created a person called wife and served me. So first of all, I should not be speaking anything. And if at all I speak, my speech should convey only the gratitude to the Bhagavan. And because Bhagavan has done it through the instrument of wife, my gratitude should go to the wife. Then the cycle is properly complete. Unfortunately, we are so much used to himsa, and our himsa is through the opinion, matam. We have thousands and thousands of opinion about things around, and most of these opinions are acrimonious opinion, bitter opinions, laced with the hatred. Mind well, hate is himsa. Very casually we say, oh, that man is like that. Oh, these people are like that. Oh, talking about Indians, they're all hopeless. Oh, Western world, that's all hopeless. What if this food is hopeless? That is bad. This is bad. This is, every word is laced with hatred. That's all himsa. Whether the recipient of those words is present or absent is immaterial. Mind well, every hate is a curse. It creates vibration in the environment that you have. Why do you think the presence of a saintly person gives enormous amount of happiness? All the Western disciples who came to meet Neem Karoli Baba, all of them without even speaking English, because Baba did not know English, but all of them felt extremely happy. And mind well, most of them were LSD and drug addicts. The reason why they felt happy was Neem Karoli Baba was apostle, a saintly person is apostle of nonviolence. When complete nonviolence is there, what remains there is only prem or love. Mahatma Gandhi's presence was truly inspirational. Swami Vivekananda's presence, people used to feel a big awe. They used to feel this is a person with aura. Gurudeva's lightning presence, it was all because he used to exude love. And you exude love, it is possible only when ahimsa is at its peak. So this is the first niyama, yama, and we need to focus in our sadhana on that. My body physically, my mind mentally or psychologically, my speech verbally should not hurt anyone. To stop the hurting through these three mediums, the best course is to take opposite action. If you don't want the fire to burn you, you immerse yourself in water, the fire cannot do anything. If you want to be away from ahimsa, be immersed in prema always. So let your vani speak mrudu softly with complete affection about everyone. Violence automatically subsides. To do this, the ahankara has to be completely given away. Do not think yourself as very intelligent person, knowledgeable person, separate from others, highly elevated. Drop all those coverings. Think of all of them as your own. Have a madhura vani. In Hindi, they say, aisi vani boliye, jaise mishri ghul gayi hai. As if the sugar is dropping drop by drop, sugar syrup. That doesn't mean false praise. Don't do that, because then the second part will be vitiated, satyam. Let the body be for the pleasure of others. So serve, be in the service of everyone. Speak madhuravani with everyone and think of welfare of all. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha. Let all be happy. Sarve santu niramaya. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu na kaschit dukkha bhagbhavet. Na kaschit dukkha bhagbhavet. Let nobody suffer. In this prayer, universal prayer, the word I is not used. And in order to see that no one suffers, you also don't suffer. So ahimsa, to practice ahimsa, first the himsa is to be stopped. And to stop the himsa, you have to be very mindful of what you are thinking, acting, and speaking. We do all the three without thinking. Very rarely we think after the action, and very, very, very rarely we think and act. That is why ahimsa needs to be perfected by any of the sadhaka in any of the marga. Without ahimsa, in our satsang also, many a times we try to give suggestion, but the suggestions are very acrimonious. They are, somebody fold your hands and correct. Yeah, right meaning. Don't argue. In sadhana panchakam, Guruji was telling, arguments are to be avoided. Why? Because they become personal. And personal argument is himsa. On the point, people when you express your opinion. Unfortunately, we are so much used to giving opinion. We have become a Rai Chand. Everywhere there is a Rai that we have to give. Our objective is to become Jnana Chand, not Rai Chand. So Ahimsa is the first of the Yamas to be practiced. The backdrop of Yama Niyama we have seen, the first Yama Ahimsa we have seen in short. In the next session, we will see what is Satya. Hari Om. Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Go ahead. Just wait if anyone has questions.
Hari Om, Sanjay Ji. When we think about Ahimsa, and you mentioned about the Ahimsa, we feel so bad that we have committed so many Ahimsas in life, even continue to do. But when we think about Ahimsa, the first name coming into our mind is Mahatma Gandhi. And I remember you once told about how he, when a mosquito was disturbing him during some discussion, how patiently he was just waving his hands not to hurt the mosquitoes. These qualities is coming from past birth or through practice he learned.
Hari Om, this remember is a continuation of the practice than in the previous births. Unless somebody is born as an avatar, like Ramakrishna Paramahansa was an avatar because he had no prarabdha. So he came to exhibit these qualities. But for others, including Mahatma, Bogies yester births, so they have perfected this art over a period of many births, and that is how for them it comes naturally to them. Mahatma Gandhi got addicted to truth so badly that he could not speak anything other than the truth, and this happened because he was a votary and practitioner of the truth in his earlier births. So all the daivi sampatti that you create is coming from your earlier practices, but in this birth you further perfect it. So human birth is for perfecting what you have perfected so far, so that you can take it to the level of perfection. Hari Om.
Hari Om, Dr. Sanjay Ji. Just two queries. Is there a relation between Shamadama and Yamaniyama? This is one thing. And another thing, in Samartha Ramdasa in Manaji Shloka, just like very first shlokas are coming, Jani Nindate Sarva Soduni Dave, Jani Vandate Sarva Bhave Karave. I think that is covering most of the Yamaniyama.
Absolutely. Ish Shada Sampat that we study in Advaita is nothing else but the reflection of Yama Niyamas. The way of putting it is different. One, you call it as control of your senses. Another name for the same is Yama. Both are same. The way it helps us in understanding Yama Niyama better than Shamadama is, Shamadama is the philosophical aspect of Yama Niyama. Supposing you are told a given advice that be good in the world. It's a correct advice, but you don't understand. Be good, okay. Be good means what? Our buddhi is at a lower level. So we need specifics for us to do sadhana. For example, if I tell anybody that please have your health, keep your health very good, he will say, okay. But he will not understand precisely what I am talking. But if I tell him that go for the morning walk every day, oh, he suddenly understands it. Going for the morning walk and be healthy, both are same. But one is more at a strategic advice, another is implementable advice. So yama niyamas are something that can be deciphered more easily because of specificity compared to the generalization that we see in shamadama. But essentially, both are same. For example, you have a very big judgment given by a judge. If you start reading from beginning, we are not interested. We directly go to the operational part called decree, where it is written that the concerned murderer should be hanged. That is the part of essence which we understand. But before that, the judge gives the entire explanation why that particular order has been given. So the explanation, the philosophical basis, the general order, the strategic advice is shada sampat. Implementable advice, which is easier to understand, is yama niyama. Essentially, both are same. Hari. And what Samartha Ramadas has said is nothing else but yama niyama. Jani nindyate yama. Jani vandyate niyama. Hari.
Hari.
Hari Om, Sanjayji. Yes, you know, you have many times, you know, talked about the spiritual growth of Gandhiji. And I mean, absolutely, when you look from that perspective, you know, at a different level completely from everybody else. Just a question is, and you also mentioned that, you know, these are practices when you move away from the Vyavharika world to the spiritual world. So my general question is, should a spiritual aspirant live in the Vyavharika world and, you know, conduct and take up a position? Because if he's operating from the spiritual level, he may or may not. And I think that is the reason why Gandhi has been, you know, there are so many detractors of what. So if you can just share your, you know, what is the way to deal with this kind of a situation?
Your question actually points out to a very basic fundamental question. How do we reconcile Vyavaharika Vishwa with Adhyatmika Vishwa or Adhyatmika Satta? And the answer to that is, when you are burning in fire, if you give a sermon to that person saying that, you know, you shouldn't have gone in the fire, why didn't you think of the fire earlier, you shouldn't have actually taken a lot of precautions, that is of no use because he is already in fire. So the advice that he needs is how to come out of the fire, and then he requires an advice how not to get into the fire. So we are already immersed in Vyavaharika Vishwa. Now in Vyavaharika Vishwa, we cannot use Adhyatmik Satta as it is unless we have mastered the Adhyatmik Satta and entered into Vyavaharik Satta. See, Gurudev or any saintly person, and Mahatma Gandhi also, perfected the Adhyatmik Satta and then entered into Vyavaharik Satta, so they never went wrong. Simply because they came in Vyavaharik Satta, people in Vyavaharik Satta started judging them right or wrong, and that is why their judgment has got no meaning. So Mahatma Gandhi was revered by every single saintly person, right from Swami Chinmayananda Gurudev to Shivananda Maharaj to Ramana Maharshi to Periyavad Shankaracharya. That is because they realized who he is. But people who were in Vyavaharika Vishwa, they had their own questions that this man made India defunct. He was too much non-violent. You have to fight somewhere. These are our very shallow brains criticizing them, because what is happening is the criticism is leveled against him from a different level. So, for example, Ramakrishna Paramahansa shouted at one of his disciples when he told him that please take this particular thing is infested with cockroach, take it outside and kill the cockroaches and come back. And the disciple went out, did not kill the cockroaches and came back, and Ramakrishna shouted at him. How do you reconcile this with nonviolence, ahimsa? That is why what ahimsa is only possible to be known when it is done by a jnani. So our definition is from many times laced with Vyavaharika Vishwa. Now the most critical part of the question is, what about me? How do I reconcile it in my daily life? Let us take an example. You cannot admonish anybody because admonish means a person will get hurt. But when I am in Vyavaharika Vishwa, I am the CEO of the organization. When I shout at somebody, it is definitely not ahimsa, it is himsa. However, this, because I am in Vyavaharika Vishwa, when I impart this particular violence upon him, the greater good is justifying it in Vyavaharik Vishwa. It cannot be justified in Adhyatmik Vishwa. But in for the greater good, let us take example. Is it not that you cut the tree, an Ayurveda practitioner plucks the grass, cuts the tree, but makes the medicine out of it and saves somebody's life? So violence led to saving of somebody's life. Does that justify the violence in Adhyatmik Vishwa? No. But in Vyavaharik Vishwa, yes. Now then, what is the solution? How do you practice nonviolence? Get out of Vyavaharik Vishwa. How do you get out of Vyavaharik Vishwa? Don't become CEO. Why will you not become CEO? Don't have prarabdha. Then you will not become CEO. How can I not have prarabdha? Don't do the karma with phalam. If you don't do karma with phalam, you're not required to be born. If you're not required to be born, where is the question of violence? That is how the trail goes. But now the question is, sir, it is fine. You're telling me, I agree with you, but right now I'm stuck. I don't know what to do. No, there is a solution there. First of all, reduce your Vyavaharik Vishwa as much as you can. How do you reduce it? Optional Vishwa is to be completely abandoned. What is optional Vyavaharik Vishwa? Going to the restaurant. You will not go to the restaurant, and then you will not fight with somebody who is trying to touch you there, who is not following the sanitation rules. All the commotion in your mind, hinsa in your mind, all that came simply because you went there. Was it necessary to go there? No, but sir, I am a married man. What can I do? Then take the family there. Let them enjoy. You remain calm. So you have fulfilled the duty of a father or as well as a husband of taking the family there, and yet you are not there. This is called swimming without the touch of water. You have to practice this art. So that is why in satsang, we all come together and discuss about God, about dharma, about everything. But moment it is over, we start asking, is it raining there? How is it? How is COVID, corona there? Again, you indulge into wrong things. Moment the satsang is over, switch off. Go back to your thinking. Don't get, the mind tries to slip into general discussions. I've seen many a times the ladies attending satsanga, after the satsang is over, it was Akshaya Tritiya, they started talking about buying gold ornaments. It defeats the purpose. That is why Tapovan Maharaj, in his jhopadi, the small hut, hardly 7-8 students were there, but he did not allow them to even gossip around the hut. And Gurudev was also told not to have gossip. Why? Any worldly thing, try to avoid as much as you can. When it is inevitable, fine. But our inevitability, we have increased a lot. Why do you need to go to everybody's house for food? Why do you need to call everybody to your house for food? And more interactions mean more violence. Why? Because we are not the right people to interact. Loka Sangraha is the prerogative of saintly people, not us. More we get exposed to the world, more we get entangled, more violence comes. Why? He is a bad man. He is not. How she looks at it. See, look at the ladies, what they do. Even if somebody has dressed properly, two ladies will discuss. Look at her. It doesn't suit her, you know. That should have been actually light pink in color. All this is nothing else but himsa. So that is why in Vyavaharika Vishwa, as far as possible, reduce the diameter of your Vyavaharika Vishwa. Reduce the contact. Sangha. Make it less. And then once you do this, your punyam will go up so that next time you will not be born as a CEO. Next time you will be born as a poor Brahmin, but studying for the case. And Brahmin means not caste. The one who is studying for Brahma Vidya. And then naturally, look at what happened to Gurudeva. In spite of the fact that he could have undertaken Vyavaharika Vishwa, his previous punyam pushed him towards going to Himalayas. As a result, what happened? He was away from violence, away from everything, because he was, unfortunately, everybody doesn't have that privilege. And that privilege will come only by practicing punyam. So keep on doing dharma punya sanchaya so that the situation becomes conducive to do the yama niyamas. Hari Om.
Hari Om ji. Thank you very much, sir, for all of us. My one little question or doubt was, you know, we have people like Krishna, who, because of, we studied a whole lot that, you know, following dharma is right, because in that situation, that was what was required. And I'm, you know, my discussion is on the other side, where you have Gandhi, who, for whatever reason, lived a more spiritual life than a Vyavaharika life, as a general observation, because right or wrong, there, like you mentioned, there are many decisions which are questioned. So, for those, just for understanding, maybe I'm not the prime minister or, you know, any of those, but in the Vyavaharika field, is it, you know, perhaps more appropriate to be like Krishna or, you know, any of the, when you talk of Janaka as somebody who was a king and he was also, when you're doing in Vyavaharika, you have to do that role to the best, like you mentioned. And perhaps otherwise there is a mix. And then you're neither here nor there. I mean, just an observation.
Correct. First of all, observe where you are. If you are in Rome, then be a Roman. But see that you don't go to Rome. See, this is the crux of the thing. If you are already in fire, see how you can get out of the fire. And then think about how not to get into the fire. So that is why when you are in Vyavaharika Vishwa, you have to think of the situation and act accordingly. For example, I am married. You're already in Vyavaharika Vishwa. Now you cannot say that from tomorrow onwards, I will go to Himalayas. Who will look after the children? No, but looking after children is less important than getting Brahma Vidya. That is right, sir. But you are already entangled here. You have undertaken this journey on your own. Now first fulfill the duty. This duty, which is called dharma. That is why Krishna spoke about dharma throughout the Bhagavad Gita. But ultimately told what? Sarva dharman parityajya. See, this is very important. Krishna's smile is not easily understood. It is very cryptic. He gave all the advice to Arjuna as far as the war was concerned. But while giving the advice of Vyavaharika Vishwa, he was preparing him for the Adhyatmik Vishwa. So he kept on telling him that you will lose your Varna Sankar will happen, Kula Sankar will happen, people will feel bad about you. Please take up your arms, fight with them, kill with them. Don't worry, I have already killed them. Everything he said. Then he said, look, dharma is important. There is nothing beyond dharma. If you don't, it will be adharma if you don't fight. And after that, slowly he prepared him and told him, sarva dharman parityajya. If every dharma was to be left, then why this dharma was taught? That is because Arjuna was in Vyavaharika Vishwa. Bhagavan Sri Krishna had taken a Vyavaharika Satta role. So he perfected that. That is why Sri Krishna is called the Almighty. He could do. He was, and that is why Arjuna is called Savyasachi. Savyasachi means he could fire the arrows from right as well as left hand. The real meaning is not that. The real meaning is he was able to be in Vyavaharika Vishwa as well as this. That is why, in order to master that, you can be master of both the worlds, you have to understand one thing. Perfect yourself in Vyavaharik Vishwa so that you become ideal candidate for Adhyatmik Vishwa. But those who have perfected themselves in Adhyatmik Vishwa, they can very easily enter into Vyavaharik Vishwa. That is why Mahatma Gandhi, when he entered into Vyavaharika Vishwa, he had already perfected himself in Adhyatmik Vishwa. That is why, if you read his biography, he always said there was an inner voice. Are you trying to tell me that Mahatma Gandhi took the decision of calling non-cooperation movement off after the Chauri Chaura incidents by his personal opinion? You are mistaken, sir. Do you think he decided to just pick up some salt from somewhere? Do you think it is a personal decision? You are mistaken, sir. Because for such people, it is the divine decision that works through them. So every decision, what happened? Suddenly the freedom fighter Yogi Arvind decided to go and abandon the politics. You think it is a personal decision? It is not. Because for such decision, Gurudeva decided to have Gita Jnana Yajna. Was it Gurudeva's decision? No, sir. It was divine decision working through Gurudeva, because they have no more mind of them. That is why those who are full of mind, Vyavaharika Vishwa, should never analyze those decisions of the people who are without mind, Amana Avastha. That is the reason there is so much controversy about Mahatma Gandhi, because he came in the field. He is the only saint who came in complete field of action. Most of the saintly people have gone away from society and preached. Mahatma Gandhi came in the mainstream of society and took a common cause. That is why maximum controversy is about him, because you have different decisions to be taken. Nobody will question why Swami Vivekananda went for a Parivrajaka Vrata, because that is not a common thing. Nobody would question Gurudeva about why did he go to Uttar Kashi. But everybody can question Gandhi because he came into the mainstream politics. The most busy activity of mankind is politics. And that is why maximum controversy. Hari Om.